All right. So tonight I'm going to be telling you guys my testimony. I'm a little nervous, but we're going to get over that. We're chilling. So growing up, I had a good family life up until around six when my dad and my mom got a divorce. And so ever since then, it kind of went downhill. They didn't argue in front of me because they didn't want it to affect my life later on in the future, but things would twist out of line. But so that happened, and then fast forward about a year, they got back together, and then they divorced again, middle school relationship stuff. But so after the second time, it was half on, half off court decision with my parents. And so that was going well. And then about 6 months later, I was taken from for 2 years because my dad found out she was doing drugs, because I went home one day and I saw this little baggie under the sink. And keep in mind, I'm nine at this time, so I didn't know what it was. So when I get back to my dad's, I tell my dad about it, and he knew exactly what it was. So then he contacted his lawyer, and then my mom got all her rights taken away from seeing me. So that was fun. And then fast forward about a year and a half later, when she got her life on track again, I was starting to be able to see her with visitation rights, with being supervised by somebody that the court decides. So that was pretty hard because I could barely see my mom, and being so young, your parents are a big part of your life. And so then after a couple months, the court decided that we could go back to me, or my dad deciding when I go back over to my mom, so we did every other weekend. And I go back to my mom's, and after a while I come to find out that my mom still hasn't changed. There would be nights where I wouldn't have a home to sleep at. I'd be sleeping in cars. I'd sleep on mattresses that have pee on them. And I was left unsupervised a lot when I was with my mom. And on top of that, I would always have to go to the hospital for my stomach issues. I had really bad acid reflux, so I couldn't drink a lot of acidity stuff, so that wasn't fun. And then, during this time, I had to put down my childhood dog. That's not really that big, but at the same time, I grew up with that dog, so it left an effect on me. And at the time, I didn't know, because my dad said that they just had to give him away because he bit somebody, instead of actually, telling me that he died, because he knew it would hurt me really bad, so my dad was looking out for me. And then my mom met this guy named Shane, and to this day, he's still one of my best friends, because me and him have a really good relationship. But about a year into, no, I'd say 5 years, so this is four, so this is by the time I'm 11, or I got my timing mixed up, but you get it. This is when I'm 11, I start witnessing fights between my stepmom and my mom and my stepdad. And they weren't bad at first. They were just verbal arguments. And it would get worse and progressively worse over time, to where cops had to be called and there was bloodshed and all that fun stuff. But so that happened. And there's this one night where it got really bad, to the point where I was asleep in my room after playing Fortnite when it was in its prime. And I'm asleep, and then I wake up to the sound of screaming, and my mom comes in, and I noticed that there was blood on the door, from her finger. And, I was really confused, because I had woken up for dead sleep, and I was like, why is there blood on the door? And my mom was she was bawling, she was like, I love you, and all this stuff. And, I get up and I go to talk to Shane outside, because me and him have this relationship where he listens to me and I listen to him. So he likes to take advice from me and I like to take advice from him. And I was talking to him and he said that my mom, I have to say this real quick, but my mom is the manipulative type and she likes to pick and nab on people and get in people's faces and stuff. So she knew that got to my stepdad, so she would always like pick and nab at him. So that night my stepdad wasn't having it and my mom was doing that, and my stepdad pushed my mom away into the cow or the fridge, and it all went down from there, and they start and then my mom started hitting my stepdad, and my stepdad or my mom had his finger or her finger in his face, and my stepdad bit her finger to get her away from him because she was getting out of hand, and then couches were being thrown, and then me and my brother had to back away my stepdad from my mom because it was getting to the point where he could have went to jail if he touched her, but and I took my little stepbrother in the room because I knew he already had a hard enough life. But I so then it came outside because Shane went outside and my mom followed him, and it got to the point where my stepdad said, "Before I leave tonight, I'm gonna bash your skull in," and so that was like really scary. I called the cops because I didn't know what else to do. But and then they would break up and then get back together. They were in this like toxic loop that they couldn't get out of. So it was just so tiring. And at the point, or after a while, like to the age of 14, I was just numb to it. And it happened like every weekend I was there. And I knew sometimes it was my stepdad's fault, but a lot of times it was my mom's fault because she would always find something to argue about, the littlest things, and then it would kick off from there because she'd never stop. And fast forwarding to this summer, because over time it got better, because I never told my dad anything about this because I still wanted to see my mom. So fast forward to this summer, I was at my mom's for half the summer. Within the last 2 weeks of being there, they hadn't really fought a lot when I was there this summer. Like, they were getting better. But in the last 2 weeks I was there, after I got back from the Delaware State Fair, I was Call of Duty. And my stepdad comes in, and he was on the verge of tears. And he was like, "Yo, your mom just told me that, or your mom just told your brother that I hated him." And my stepdad was stressing about that because he didn't want my brother, who is at in college now, to think that he hated him because he loved us with all of his heart. And so that happened, and then that conversation turned into like an hour conversation about baseball because we both play baseball, and it's something like we that we really love. And so my we're just sitting out on the porch, and my dad has the Yuengling in his hand, or I think it was a Budweiser. But we're sitting out there, and then this is after dinner, and my mom comes out, and he's like, my mom says to my stepdad, "You didn't eat all your food." And my stepdad, he was in a good mood. He's like, "I know, I know. I'll be back and eat it." And my mom was starting arguments again, back to her old days, and she was like. And then she snatched his beer out of his hand and then went in, slammed the door, and then she dumped it. And then my stepdad went in, and I was there with him, and he was like, "Yo, where's my beer?" And then my mom was like, "I dumped it out because you're not eating my dinner." And then, like, time flies. And then my mom was like, "I'm never cooking for you again. You're ungrateful." Some words were being said that I can't say here. So then my stepdad's like, "Whatever, I'm not fighting." So he goes to take a shower, and then he lays down in his bed, and 5 minutes, I would have to say, because I'm watching Baylen Levine, but 5 minutes go by, and my mom goes back into the room when he's already like half asleep, And then she starts, I don't know how it all happened, but I walked in at the perfect time to see it. But she starts like pointing in his face and like calling him names and stuff and just wanting to get an argument out of him because, I don't know, she just wanted it because she knew she could try and get away with it. But so she's pointing at him and my stepdad gets up and he's all confused and he's starting to get mad at this point. So I take him outside and I'm like, take some breaths, and it's not worth it to fight because we've already been through this for the past 7 years of our lives. And big brother's still there, and thankfully he was, because if not, it would have been a lot worse than it was. So that happens, and then it starts to get more intense, like 10 minutes into it. And they start to fight, like not like physical, but they're like getting worse and worse with their words. And then my stepdad, he's like starting to get physical. So I back him off, and I'm like, whoa, dude, we can't be doing this. Cops can be involved, and you can go to jail. So then my stepdad slams out the door, and then my mom locks it. And then he tries to get in, and he starts beating in the door because it was a trailer, so it wasn't really hard to beat through. But then my mom calls the cops, and she's crying on the phone, and she's saying, oh, my husband domestic abuse or violence, and he's trying to break into our house or my house and all this stuff, making up lies to the cops that totally weren't true. So then my stepdad's getting real mad because he's getting framed for something he didn't do, and my stepdad walks out the house and I walk out with him, and he's like, we can just wait here till the cops get here. And so the cops of course ask my mom what happened first because she was the one who called. So and then she tells them her twisted side of the story, saying he abused her, he hit her, he was trying to break in the house, which keep in mind the house is his because he's paying for all of it. And my mom really, I don't know what she does with her money still, but so and then the cops ask, and then the cops go over to my stepdad and they talk and get his side of the story, and he's detained. And thankfully Caden, which is my little stepbrother, wasn't there at this time, so he didn't have to witness all this. But so Shane gets in the back of the cop car, and then the cops come and look or come and talk to me and my brother and ask what we have or what happened. And we tell him our side of the story, which lined up with Shane's instead of my mom's. And the cops were going to detain him, but the cops told us to take him to his mom's house, which his mom lived like 20 minutes away. So the cops asked us to take him to his mom's house. So we got all our stuff. And before I left, my mom turned to me and she called me an a-hole and said that she's glad she never has to see me again. So that happened, and we left with my stepdad to take him to my mom's house, and or his mom's house. And then my mom starts calling him, and he's like, where are you going? All this stuff, being crazy. And my stepdad isn't talking to her. We stop at Rofo, and then after we drop Shane off, say our goodbyes, because we don't know the last time we're gonna see him. But after we say our goodbyes, our mom calls us, and she's like flipping out on us, and she's like, why would you lie to the cops and all this stuff? Why do you always take Shane's side over mine? And I tell her, I'm like, mom, you have been lying over the past, I don't even know how long, and you always blame stuff on Shane. But have you ever sat down and think to yourself that maybe it's you that's causing the issues? So then it was like 1 o'clock in the morning, and we were on our way back to my dad's. And then I'm telling my dad everything about it, and then my mom is like threatening to cut all of or me and Michael off. And at this point, I'm already planning to do it because I need a break from my mom. And then we were like, we're praying for you, mom. And I was like, you need Jesus and stuff like that. And then my mom goes, your God's a myth. And at the time, I knew she didn't mean it, but at the same time, that's like one of the unforgivable sins, blasphemy. And so over the next little while, my mom's blocked, and I didn't talk to her for a solid month. And then I unblock her, and I'm still like not wanting to open up to her at this point, because this was at the end of like September. And so I unblock her, and I was like, I'm not gonna text her, call her, or anything. I'm waiting for her to speak out to me, because if she really loved me, then she wouldn't have said those things to me. But so she tries to reach out a couple times. I don't fall into it. And then it was just this one day, I text my mom and I forgive her. And I know in my heart I haven't fully forgiven her yet, because I'm still working on it. But I text her and I'm like, look, mom, I love you. And I know there's a lot of pain and hurt that you caused, but I'm going to forgive you. But there's still stuff that needs to be fixed. And then now we kind of like talk a little bit, but I'm still like, it's still hard to talk to her because of the stuff that happened that night. It's pretty much my story, but I guess what I want you guys to take away from this is, no matter how low in life you are, and no matter how lost and far away from God you feel, there's always a better answer, and that is God. And I feel like God used my life to pull me closer, and I felt like it was on my heart to share it with you guys today. God can take any bad situation like he did in my life and make it good by pulling you closer to him.
What happens when it's an emotionally abusive situation, or when you're a kid and you have to be the parent to your parents? What happens when it's a situation that puts us in danger? That's something that I didn't touch on last week, is it? So I'm going to read Matthew chapter 18. We're going to wind it back a little bit. We're going to be starting verse 15, and we're going to go to verse 20. Jesus, actually, before teaching this message about the parable of the unforgiving servant and what he calls us to, he actually gives us a model on how to confront people who have wronged us. And that's starting in verse 15. I have a different translation than I think that you guys do, but just follow along. So if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault, between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. Cool. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. Get yourself a support group, right? If he refuses to listen to them, then tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two or three on earth agree about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. Some of you have heard that verse before, but you've never really like heard it in context and what it actually means. So Jesus is teaching us here about how God wants us to confront people in our lives in the most graceful way possible. And it starts with confronting that person yourself. So if somebody does something wrong to you, you're to confront that person yourself, if safe. And we'll get to that in a second. Confront that person yourself and telling them what they did wrong. It's like, hey, you did this. You know, it hurt my feelings, or, you know, it hurt me. Like, this was wrong the way that you did this. And it gives them the opportunity to acknowledge what they did and to ask you for forgiveness. This is what we call giving someone the benefit of the doubt. Makes sense? We talk about giving somebody the benefit of the doubt all the time, right? But that's basically what it's talking about here. If they listen to you the first time, if they don't listen to you the first time, take someone else back with you to back you up. This could be a couple of mutual friends, a leader, a parent. This gives them a second opportunity to you, and maybe at some point they're going to be able to see like what they've done wrong. Maybe you'll speak sense into them, and again, they can ask for forgiveness, and you can continue that relationship. But if that doesn't work, Jesus says to get the church involved. This could be the church, right? It could be me. It could be one of your leaders. It could just be any authority figure that can be there to back you up. And that's what it's talking about here, to mediate the situation, giving the person a third opportunity to recognize what they did wrong and to reconcile the relationship. If this third attempt doesn't work, you're to treat that person as a Gentile and tax collector. Does anybody know what that means? Okay, anybody else? Natalie? Outsider? Outcast. Okay, you separate yourself from that person. You're no longer like required or anything like that to be in a relationship with a person who continually hurts you over and over and over again, unrepentantly. That means they've refused to see the things that they've done wrong. They refuse to admit any kind of wrong. And they continue to hurt you. You're free to back away from that person. Right? And that's something that we didn't talk about last week. We talked about the hardcore answer of what Jesus tells us about forgiveness. Right? But he also allows for boundaries. And that's what I wanted to talk about today. So this is called setting healthy boundaries. Jesus doesn't expect us to engage in relationships with people who continue to hurt us intentionally and unapologetically. Proverbs 4:23, you don't have to go there. In the NIV, it says, above all else, guard your heart, because everything you do flows from it. When we set healthy boundaries with people, it's important to understand that these are boundaries without bitterness. A lot of times, that's really the big distinction when it comes to forgiveness and how do I forgive? If I'm supposed to forgive, forget, and reconcile, but what if I can't reconcile? Then how do I forgive and set these boundaries, but not be bitter and not be angry? The key to setting boundaries is it's boundaries without bitterness. Boundaries without bitterness. A lot of us been hurt in so many ways, but it's boundaries without bitterness. So, Matt, thank you again. Very proud of you for sharing your story. I have a similar story to Matt. When I was 6, my dad was a raging alcoholic. He was in his mid-30s at the point. He started get way into it to the point where there would be physical abuse. There would be blood drawn in my house. And there, I remember a specific point in my life when I was four or five or six or something like that, where I came downstairs and my parents are throwing things across the room, and I literally stood there like this and I said, maybe you guys need to take a break from each other. How many of you at 4 years old had to do that? How many of you at this point in your life had to do that? How many of you at this point in your life had to be parents to your parents? I had to grow up a lot quicker, as Matt has. Had to grow up a lot quicker than people should have to grow up. And, you know, my parents get divorced, you know, fast forward and everything, you know, get into it. At 6, I basically had to be my mother's husband emotionally. And all the stuff that she had to dump on me, I was the only one in the house that could actually take it. I had a younger sister, so I was also trying to protect her. And then to the point, you know, there's court systems involved when it comes to divorce, so there's visitation and all that kind of stuff. So me and my sister would visit my dad every Sunday after church. Later on, when we started going to church, we would visit every Sunday. And I got to watch for years as my dad rotted away in bed because he couldn't stop drinking alcohol and doing drugs. And it got to the point where I loved spending time with my dad, but I couldn't sit there anymore and just watch him kill himself slowly while we watched The Fairly Odd Parents on TV, right? I couldn't sit there and watch him do that. I couldn't bear the smell anymore, the stains on the carpet, the bottles under the bed. I couldn't bear doing that anymore. It was no longer healthy for me, and I loved my dad to death, but I could not put myself or my sister in that situation anymore. So when I was 13, 14, something around there, I made the decision that we weren't going to go visit anymore. As much as it pained me to draw that boundary with my dad, I was guarding my heart. I didn't know it at the time. I wasn't a Christian even at the time. I was guarding my heart and from continued hurt and risking this deep-rooted bitterness that I could have had, that I did have. We mentioned that it's a process, right? When we try to forgive and all that kind of stuff, right? So over time, I wasn't angry with him, though. I just wished it could be different. Why doesn't he love me? Why, I know that he loves me, right? So I'm on recording right now. I'm probably going to get in trouble. So why doesn't he love me? Why can't he choose me over that stupid bottle? Why can't he just get his life together? And that's the stuff that we ask ourselves a lot of times, especially if we come from dysfunctional families. Why did they do that to me? Right? This is real stuff. I wasn't angry with him. I just wished it could be different, and I wished that he could change, that things would change, that we'd get back to like a normal family. There were times when like my mom dated for a while where I was like, just marry somebody because I can't take this anymore. I can't take being your emotional support as a 14-year-old. Like, marry somebody so I can get a little bit of freedom and get myself in trouble, which I probably would have. So this is a very different reaction, though. Just at, like, wishing that it could be different is a very different reaction from bitterness, from not wanting to ever see him again, from wishing him harm or ill. That's something that we need to be really careful about, and that's where we have to draw the distinction here, right? Nobody's expecting anybody in this room to be perfect when it comes to forgiveness. Jesus isn't expecting you to be different when it comes to forgiveness. He might set a standard for you to aim for, right? But he doesn't expect you to actually hit that standard. What he does expect you to do is to make sure that you're not angry or bitter and committing murder in your heart against people. That's what he expects. The last thing I wanted to point out to you as we go through these steps, though, the Bible allows for your relationship to be placed on hold, especially for the bigger hurts when you're going through this three-step process, right? Go to them alone, right? You guys are teenagers, right? Go to them alone. Can they admit their fault, and can you restore that relationship? If not, take two or three with you. Hey, told you this before, but you kind of really hurt me. I just like wish you would like, you know, like, what do you feel about this or whatever? If they don't hear it, then you're taking an authority figure with you, right? But what happens when you can't do that, right? What happens if somebody physically hurts you? He does not. Relationship on hold because we don't want to extend ourselves or allow ourselves to be hurt any further by this person. Right. For the doozies, we've experienced physical sexual harm. That boundary needs to be set immediately. Immediately. If you know of any of your friends who have experienced this, you can encourage them in that. This boundary needs to be set immediately because you don't want to put yourself in that situation to be physically or sexually harmed again and trying to reconcile. That's how we get into toxic relationships, guys. Toxic relationships where people will manipulate you to do things over and over and over and over again, and you just want to believe the best. That is a toxic relationship. But when we set these boundaries, it needs to be a posture of super hard to do, of compassion, a posture of forgiveness, a posture of wishing that it could be different. I'm no longer going to put myself in that situation, but I wish things could be different. And I don't wish any harm on that person. In fact, even in these cases, the most healthy thing to do would be to tell a trusted person about the hurt that you've experienced, so they can be confronted apart from you if you are hurt. Because like justice still needs to be done, right? Like they need that you don't need to be placed in harm's way, but sometimes people need to be held accountable for the things that they do. But when you follow the steps outlined in Scripture, you can make sure that you're approaching relationships and boundaries with a clear conscience. That's really what we want to get to. We're approaching these relationships and these boundaries and these hurts and forgiveness and whether or not how to move through these things with a clear conscience based on what Jesus tells us about relationships. And Jesus even tells us this is something that usually gets taken out of context. Whatever will be bound on earth will be bound in heaven. Some of us have heard that in a lot of different ways. It just means that after you followed all of these steps and that person is to be treated as separate from you, you have a clear conscience. Whatever will be bound on earth, whatever decision you make about the boundaries that you need to set in that situation, God will honor. Because you can do it with a clear conscience. That's how we obey what God has called us to. That's how we obey the high standard without ever actually feeling like we have to hit it, right? Forgiveness is not something that, like, I realize that there were probably misconceptions about what I shared last week about, like, you know, okay, so if I don't forgive, will God forgive me? The bigger question is, when you have a relationship with Christ, will your life bear fruit? Can I share the conversation we had? Okay. So one of the conversations that Matt and I had when we were on the Spiritual Life Retreat, we happened to be in the same small group, and one of the questions that he asked is, how do I know that I'm saved? And this was after he had shared the same testimony with the guys upstairs. And really the best way to know that you're saved, and I know this was a question that more than one person asked, is your life bearing fruit? Do you see a change in your life? Do you see a change in your heart? So, of course, I look over to Matt because I knew about his testimony when it came to forgiveness, and that's why I invited him. I was like, of course you're saved. You profess faith in Jesus, and you will forgive a parent for putting you through that? That's fruit in your life. So it's not necessarily the fact that, like, oh, well, if you don't forgive, then Christ won't forgive you. It's just like, no, if you're saved, you'll forgive. If you're saved, you'll have patience. If you're saved, you will love people. It's natural fruit that is produced through having saving faith in Jesus. So remember, like, as hard as this can be for a lot of us, we're called to obey Christ and his truth over everything else that we might feel. And know that you have a great support system here in me and your leaders to walk you through things. Hopefully you have parents that you can go through. If you don't, we can always be that for you. But we know this stuff is hard. So hopefully Matt's story encouraged you guys tonight, just to kind of give you like a real life example, so we're not just like giving you guys hypotheticals all the time, right? But a real life example about what people go through and how they're supposed to exercise forgiveness, even when our parents hurt us or the people who are closest to us hurt us. So I want to pray for you real quick, and then you're going to sit tight, okay? Because we're going to do something different with small groups tonight. Father, thank you. Thank you for Matt. Thank you for his maturity. And, you know, even though, you know, his life situation has caused him to grow up quicker than he should have to, that you have produced fruit in his life and that he comes to you first and that you speak to his heart, that he was able to do this and set the example and be an example for his peers. We're so proud of him for that. And we just pray that, you know, you would bring healing to that relationship, you know, as long as it's healthy for him. We, you know, God knows that any of us who deal with parent situations and everything, these are usually lifelong battles that we're fighting for a long time. And hopefully there's reconciliation, but I pray that you protect his heart through the whole thing. I pray that you protect everybody's hearts here because there's hurts that haven't been voiced here. There's things that people have gone through that, you know, they just really need your help and they're not really sure what to do and they're not really sure where to go, but know that that you are their comforter. Bring comfort to them. Teach them by your word, not by their feelings. Help them to come to leaders. Help us to be a body that can build each other up. I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.